So in this video, I just want to do an overview of the Novak piece that I put up for you to have a look at. This is the basics of AI. This piece, there's a ton of stuff. It's actually quite repetitive. I'm just hitting the highlights just enough to get us going on AI. And then in later videos and other readings, we'll really dig into this stuff. But let's start with the basic stuff with AI. And I'm not even going to turn to the A in AI. I want to look at the I in AI first, namely intelligence, right? Intelligence is, the best of times, that's a term, that's a concept what we could say has fuzzy boundaries. We're not always ready and willing to assume that something is intelligent. Sometimes we deny it. Sometimes we regard it as, it's a very intelligent remark. It's like that's smart or above. Or we use this term in a variety of ways. And I think that we want to, when especially as we're going to talk about the use of intelligence, artificial intelligence in warfare, you're talking about using intelligence in the concept of within the larger concept of permissible killing, which is within the context of war. So we should be pretty sure what we're talking about when we talk about artificial intelligence. And so let's start with just the very notion of intelligence. Okay, historically, philosophers have been talking about this forever. Right? This is nothing new. Right? Sometimes some people think that it's new to talk about intelligence, that intelligence tests and intelligence tests are written into ancient philosophical manuals, right? How to be intelligent and is all part of being a moral and decent person, especially if you look at Aristotle. So, but when we think about intelligence, philosophically, we have a long tradition of this. Intelligence was regarded as some kind of power, an ability, capacity, right? This is something unique. It's a unique kind of power. Living things had powers, right? They had abilities to assemble elements. Like think about even a tree. What does a tree do? It has powers to do things. It can put water and sunlight and nutrients from the soil together, right? So biologically, biology, like having biological powers, right? These were abilities to do things. So more specifically, what intelligence was along this line of a capacity or a power to do stuff. And so in that sense, it was a power, a capacity for what we could call goal-driven thought. Now, goal-driven thought, you know, that sounds pretty abstract. Well, it certainly is. And also it's, you know, inside the subject. How do you look at, you know, like as I'm talking, I would like you to think that I have goal-driven thoughts right now, but you can't see it, right? You don't see what's going on in here, whatever happens to be going on. You infer that that's going on, goal-driven thought or some thought processes. What? How? Because of my behavior, right? You look at what's going on the outside. Philosophically, this is the old problem of other minds. How do you know that how do you guys know right now that I'm not a zombie or something like that? Well, in one strict sense of the term, you don't know that, right? I could be an automaton that's been programmed and I'm just rattling this stuff off and I don't know what any of it means. Okay, so these are old problems. That's nothing new. So this inside the subject problem, the problem of other minds, you know, that's been talked about for quite some time. Again, this is nothing new. So let's think a little bit more about this. So this powers have to be sort of stimulated, and how does that work? Well, traditionally, you had sort of a simple dichotomy here. It's internally driven, you know, Plato's sense of wonder, where does thought really come from? This, you know, there's this power, the capacity he doesn't really talk about. It's largely connected with the nature of the universe or the ultimate foundations, which he likes to call nous. But basically, why do we think? Well, we think because we have a sense of wonder. You know, the old thing from the Theaetetus that philosophy begins in a sense of wonder. So it's this kind of internal manifestation of an internal motivation of a sense to wonder. Okay, much later on, centuries later, around the year 20th century, around 1910, 1911, John Dewey, the American philosopher, really thought that, you know, made the case that what's thought? Thought, you only start thinking when your regular experiential flow is interrupted. And he has numerous anecdotes about this, but you know, you're walking down a path and you're enjoying the sunny day. You're kind of daydreaming. That's not really thought because it's not really goal driven or whatever. You're daydreaming. You might be thinking about a snack you had or a movie you watched, or just pleasantries, just idle penny for your thoughts kind of thing. And then all of a sudden you come to a fork in the road. Well, right, poets like this image too, but what do you have to do? You have to start thinking, oh, which way am I going to go, right? So you start searching your memory, and especially if it's a path you've never been along, well, then you start, I got to figure out, you know, if I go one way, I might get lost or whatever. Anyways, I think you get it. So the point is that you interrupt your experience, and then it kickstarts you into thinking as opposed to daydreaming. All right, so that's externally. But again, it's all, this thought and stuff is all going on the inside. So how do we know? Well, it's by inference, by behavior. So if I watch you come up to the path and I see you doing this and looking back and forth and then going, and I would presume that, oh, he's trying to make a decision or she's trying to make a decision about which way to go. So I presume there was a thought, a goal-driven process of thought going on. So artificial intelligence, if that's the big picture, loose and fuzzy of intelligence as a kind of capacity for goal-driven thought. Again, we really haven't articulated with thought, but I'm going to presuppose for the benefit of the story, a physicalist account, that it's taking place in the brain and not in an incorporeal soul. I'm not saying that that's a ridiculous position, but for my discussion, I'm not going to presuppose dualism. I'm going to just run a physicalist line. So it's taking place in the brain, biologically, it occurred naturally, right? Evolution produced it, you know, that's very interesting and all that. But now we're talking about, can we produce intelligence in something non-biological, like a computer, right? Or some kind of machine. And by machine, I mean a certain kind of organization that is intrinsically non-biological, just for the sake of discussion. So how do we approach this concept of artificial intelligence? Is it just a species of intelligence? Like there's natural, so NI, this is NI, and you know what you're typing into is AI, and we're just species of intelligence. In order to get a handle on this, because we can't crawl inside, right? That doesn't seem to work. I can't even know for sure, and if you're thinking and you can't know for sure directly by acquaintance, if I'm thinking, we infer it, well then let's just run that same line when we're talking about artificial intelligence. So let's just say we'll approach it like, what should an intelligent X, whatever, be able to do, right? So we look at from a behavioral line. So this is a very modern approach, right? The school of behavioralism wanted to pitch out all stuff about the internals. The subject was a black box. We don't care about that. We're just looking at behavior. And you can get a lot of mileage by looking at behavior. Many problems that people have can be solved through behavioral modifications that talking doesn't always seem to work. So it's not like the behavioral approach doesn't have a lot of merit to it. Question is how much? These are philosophical questions that we want to think about. So back to the question, what should an intelligent X be able to do? Well, interact with the world, right? So we think intelligence is a kind of capacity to interact, right? And not just interact like the way a tub of water does on a wintry day, where it sort of interacts or reacts to the world by freezing, thawing, evaporating. I mean, so there's all kinds of things that are interacting. What about a sunflower when the sun is moving and you have phototropism and you see the flower, you know, turning? Is it, and we sometimes anthropomorphize it, saying, oh, it's watching the sun go across the sky. Well, first off, the sun doesn't even go across the sky, the earth turns. But anyways, after you unpack all that, is that intelligence? Because that is an acting and reacting to the environment, right? And of course, animals biologically, we know they influence the areas that they live in. So if they eat lots of food and they have waste products, we know that can change all kinds of things, even weather and all this stuff. So there's actions and reactions. Is that intelligence? You might want to argue that it is a kind of intelligence. Maybe that's even a species of it. So as you can see, fuzzy boundaries when we start talking about intelligence. We have to make some decisions. That concept doesn't just drop out of the sky and say, here it is, fully formed. All right, but we would say, look, here's where you would start running into even problems. We would say that, no, there has to be some kind of perception beyond phototropism, some kind of perception in the sense of, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a second, but perception, understanding, action. So there has to be some kind of recognition of speech, you know, so maybe we're up from plants to like, dogs seem to recognize speech. They can my dog can recognize some commands. I think even sometimes she disobeys because she doesn't agree with the command, as Mark Twain liked to say, my dog just agrees from time to time. You know, so that would suggest that there's processing of information. It's like, yeah, I'll come with you to the park and we're going to stay as long as I want to stay, no matter how much you call me. So there's some kind of speech recognition. We would think that there has to be the ability to process images in some way, like we do. You know, you read a stop sign, you process that image. You know, again, animals process images. You know, my dog can recognize eventually after training the difference between a chew toy and the leg of a piece of furniture, right? So process the imagery you can see. And of course, also imagery that comes in through speech. And some ability to take action. So these three bulleted points, they're not watertight. So they bleed off into each other. So we would also think that the interaction with the world has reasoning and planning. We would think that the sunflower doesn't really have a representation of the world. It's maybe just reacting. But my dog seems to have some kind of representation. Her world is organized, right? She knows where beds are, where bowls are. Housebreaking is, when you think about that, right? You teach your dog where to go to the washroom. It recognizes, it makes all kinds of distinctions. The mother dog teaches the puppies that too. You know, don't go to the washroom where we all sleep. There is the beginning, the rudiments of a representation of the world. And that representation is a kind of modeling. It's based on input, right, from the mother pup to the puppies, from me to my dog. And not only that, is the dog can sometimes solve problems, you know, if it has to navigate its world. Why? Because the world changes, right? So you move something. You move a dog's water dish, it may not like it, and it can react, but eventually it can sort of figure things out. And what we expect, well, that's a sign of intelligence. And so that naturally, you know, learning and adapting to the world. So updating, modifying the representation of the world. So you think about it, it's all very dynamic, right? It's interactive, it's dynamic. The world changes, the intelligence realizes it, adapts. So as the external world changes, the modeled world changes so that the intelligent X can better accommodate the world, et cetera, et cetera. Now, we haven't got even as far as truth. We're just talking about, you know, success in terms of adapting. Like, I'm not sure my dog has a concept of truth like we do, but there is some kind of success mechanism built into her continuing modifications of her world. Like when I throw a frisbee, and the first time it hits her on the nose, and after a couple of times, she knows how to jump and catch it. So that's constant changing, right? Each time I throw it, it's a little different, but she recognizes, again, it's a similar kind of pattern of running, jumping, and catching. So, and then of course, wind comes up, and it's amazingly sophisticated how many decisions probably her little doggy brain is making as it's processing information, which is what we would expect with an intelligent a system. And then we just take this up several layers, in several levels. I mean, if you want to say that it's radically different what we do than what animals do, it's certainly a big one because, you know, my dog's not doing calculus, right? But can do very sophisticated things. But, you know, we start really going up into the goal-driven abstract things, you know, and that's where, traditionally philosophers either say, well, we've got to get sort of a dualism happening here, but it certainly is a big step up. Maybe it's continuous. We'll have to see. That's actually an empirical question. Maybe we'll find out someday that non-human animals can actually do mathematics in some way, because it seems that some of them can count, and that's interesting. Okay, but that's neither here nor there. It's just this idea that there's intelligence sprinkled throughout. So why not in artificial stuff? So what's the big deal? If we find it in us and dogs and maybe all kinds of levels, maybe the artificial one isn't a huge step. So again, how do we approach it? It's been the behavioral model. So you can have a look in the the President Novak slide presentation. There's lots of pictures of these things. And I'll talk about this more in other videos. But for now, think about this. A few key dates. I'm just going to name three. There's way more. The history of artificial intelligence is way more complicated than this. But this is good enough for now. We'll dig into more stuff later. Don't worry. 1950, Alan Turing. That's the guy that you want to know a little bit about. Well, I wouldn't say he's the father of all computing or whatever, but clearly one of the most important guys in the early days of computers. 1950, Alan Turing publishes Computing Machinery and Intelligence. We're going to have a look at that article in more detail. So it's up on the site, and I'll put a video up about that. And that's the Turing test. So, you know, basically it does relate AI to NI, because in order for something to be really AI, it's got to, for our purposes now, trick NI into thinking it's AI. So in other words, a computer or AI system, if it can make you think as an NI that it's actually an NI and not an AI, then it's full-blown artificial intelligence, right? And so you can question that, which is exactly what happens in 1980, right? And Searle's discussion has often been referred to as the Chinese room experiment. It doesn't matter, it could be any language. It just put it this way because he figured that many of his readers wouldn't understand Chinese, so they would get the imagery. But you can substitute any language that you don't understand can be plugged into this model. So what's going on here? Well, he makes an important distinction that people like Aristotle and traditionally we didn't have, and that's syntax and semantics. Computers can understand syntax, but Searle is saying they don't understand semantics. In other words, they can push symbols around and get it right, kind of like if you teach a child, if they just memorize a bunch of mathematical equations such that they can write them out quickly, and then you put, you know, 1 + 1 = and they can recognize those symbols, and they've already memorized that you just put a 2 on the other side, and they write a 2 and you go, hey, you understand how to add. No, they just know the syntax, right? They know how to set it all up. But do they really understand what adding means? That's a semantic question. Searle is saying, nope, computers, what they get syntax, right? Anyways, the next one is a date that Novak points out is important that, well, if we narrow it down and think about it, in 1997, I'm old enough to remember this, when Deep Blue beats Kasparov. Deep Blue was a computer that was one sort of the big thing when it beat a chess grandmaster. And that was predicted a long time ago that was coming. That was a big thing. Now the best, is it right to say the best player in the world right now is a computer? But we still have human grandmasters. And we don't really say the best player is a computer, even though the best computers, sorry to say, they beat the best. We lost that, right? They won that fight. But what I want to ask and for us to think about, because we're going to be looking at artificial intelligence in warfare, which means killing machines, is machine learning. Is that, we often say machine learning, and we go, oh yeah, it's human learning. Is it? Is it really the same thing? We use the same word, but as Wittgenstein said, don't be bewitched by language. Just because you say machine learning, that doesn't grant you that it's the same as human learning. If you think it does, you're begging all kinds of questions. So is this external approach of what to do, is that sufficient? Well, that's what we're going to look at in future videos.